Okay, let me introduce myself. My name is Andrey Kalev. I'm from PSLOPS. I'm founder of this project, and it's something like CloudStack built on top of open source components like KVM, OpenVSwitch, Floodlight, and of course Ceph. So I want to tell about my experience and possible caveats when doing such a project. So let's begin. We started to plan architecture in the middle of last year. So we want to build an ASP architecture which should be scalable, say to tens of racks or something else. It should be fault tolerant in means of storage, so one failure of storage node or even failure of storage rack in the future shouldn't bring down virtual machines to more than, say, seconds or so. So it leads us to use one of distributed file systems. We tried many, and we finally choose Ceph because it has the richest feature set comparing to any other, and probably right now we may say we can do anything with Ceph, which is impossible in any other distributed file system in the means of data placement. So then we need to choose hypervisor. Of course, it was KVM because of fine-grained tuning via C groups, and then Scheduler has a lot of problems before 4.2 release, so we throw it out, unfortunately. We also want to build our cluster on relatively cheap hardware. It should be Supermicros or something else. We choose Supermicros. They were relatively cheap, and we built our storage network on InfiniBand because storage network may remain flat. It doesn't need routing in at least in scale of rack, so it's a safe choice here. Also, one should mind that the things can be acceptable in the private cloud, say scheduled downtime, is completely unacceptable in the public one. We can't shut down the cluster in the Sunday night for maintenance even just for 1 hour. It will not meet downtime criteria, and public cluster should be very reliable as regular hardware is, except regular hardware dies and brings down all the VMs on this, and we shouldn't allow this. So Ceph help us to do this. Why we choose Ceph? Because it allows custom data placement, so you can group that data in buckets. You can place VMs in these buckets, and so you can pin those buckets to a set of physical nodes. I might say rack, I might say subset of rack, or superset of racks, or something else. And you have absolutely free choice on what to do with your data backup copies. So you may place him in same rack, you may place him in another rack, and if your rack suddenly dies, you can relaunch all the VMs in the minutes somewhere else without expecting any other problems. So Ceph also has very advanced KVM driver, which is very able of caching, able of customization. We did some customizations for cache. Unfortunately, CEF mailing list was rejected this because it was just to improve latency and not just to architecture improvement. Then for first version of our cluster, we choose flat networking with LAN isolation because it's quite simple. The same mechanism exploited in the OpenStack Nova, and right now it's of course obsolete, and we obsoleted it too. And there was one good point that we can hold entire configuration inside libvirt. So virtual machine config contains all necessary elements. We don't need to make any additional actions when we launch VM, and we simply start it and it will work, and isolation will work, and no other clients will be able to see public traffic. This method has some disadvantages, as you cannot build, cannot scale L2 segment up to, say, 2,000, 3,000 VMs. They will drown in the broadcast messages, and your switch probably will not support such many support serving such many LANs at a time. For first version, also we selected CollegeDB because it has monitoring plugins for CEF, for libvirt, and for a lot of system parameters. Using CollegeDB was more preferred to date. And of course, as I mentioned before, KVM hypervisor was chosen because of fine tuning, because of community, and we have and a lot of experience with them, and want to try something new. So seems we need just to write some orchestrator logic and some UI, and just start working. That's OpenStack way. And so why it may not work? Right now situation is quite different, but a year ago we have a lot of problems. The CEF currently first stable release doesn't work correctly on the intermediate states. We was not able to rebuild a cluster to change data placement in the cluster without any hard lookups to the input output. So we postponed production because of this reason. And RBD driver for QEMU has at least three, as I remember, different reasons for leaks. They have been reported to the CEF list, and they had fixed it, but it takes the time, and we also lose months or two before all those problems was fixed and pinned. So at exactly at the time we are using libvirt 0.9.11, which has not obvious support. It came with 0.10, and there is no ability to tag incoming or outgoing traffic properly inside the virtual machine ports, so we postponed this too. And we eventually launched the first version of our orchestrator. Our orchestrator works quite differently than the OpenStack, CloudStack, or any other existing type of cloud orchestrator. We put everything for local node management to the local local agent to prevent synchronization issues which right now taking place in the OpenStack, for example. All the operations, ingest agent messages, changing C group parameters, migration, start or shutdown was passed through single instance. So there's a point to do things exactly in this way. This is not modular design, but it has a lot of adventures like this. Of course, Liebert has existing infrastructure to support any type of limits. So we may use CPU cgroup for quota limitation, CPU set for pinning, and CPU act for accounting ticks and billing end users. So it's just a statistic come out from LibRD, and we just need to use it. It's quite simple. Also, we had a problem that with same RBD driver that VMs eventually leaks. We are not able to fix it properly, and we introduced delay over mechanism as Google did in 2007, as I remember. So when VM triggers OM event inside their C group, we immediately move this VM to the freezer C group, then add some memory, some limit above, then unfreeze it, and then immediately migrate it. So this leak is kind of resetting, and we can still use this VM, it will not die. It's quite ugly, but it works at the time. It took a lot of time to implement exactly this feature. And of course, we did some statistic preprocessing on the local agent because, say, 1,000 VMs generates about 5,000 statistics events per second, and no relational database able to hold this correctly. We need to approximate say 10 seconds interval or so, but we need precise statistics, so we do such preprocessing. We heavily use Qemu Jest agent with some patches which was rejected by community. This is file open, file exec, and file close additions, so we're able to launch any possible commands inside the VM and able to read or write some files, any files inside the VM. The first thing is which is very usable for this is snapshot creation. You need to do a fast freeze before creating a snapshot, even if it's atomic. Then you need to make snapshot. In case of Ceph, it was atomic, but it still break FS if you don't pass freeze call. Then you tow it back, and is it for what guest agent made for. Also, we can do some change of network configurations when we clone VM, so we simply clone VM inside the Ceph abstractions. We say snapshot, then flatten, and new VM appears. The Ceph has such mechanism. It's very important thing. In any other way, cloning will take, say, tens of minutes or so. So we just rewrite settings and fire up new VM. It takes, say, 10 seconds. No other cloud orchestrator have this feature, which is strange. No one heard it live to Ceph, even CloudStack. Of course, any upgrades, say upgrades of physical node, upgrade of kernel, emulator upgrade can be done via migration. We can do seamless migration with Ceph because at first we have live migration, and Ceph is distributed storage, which is available from any point. So we need to just push a button, wait a little, and node will be free. Then we may shut down it and do any other stuff. Of course, we did also automatic migration based on node metric to prevent resource exhaustion. It's an automatic feature when orchestrator sees that one of parameters, say CPU or memory, are close to their limits, then most greedy VMs may be migrated to free nodes, and node will die when user adds some memory just above current limit. And we choose rack-based management granularity because there is no point to make subscope of subscope management for rack, and larger scope may have points may have problems that the amount of statistics will outcome relation that relational database, and even we have a statistic preprocessing. Oh. What we tried in and what we thrown out, that's exactly pinning corresponding to the NOMA topology. It has very small effect of on regular user applications, say regular web server or small database, simply will not rely on the NOMA, and we can simply throw it out without any problem. Custom TCP congestion protocol will work only if we have some problems with long distance link, but for short links any protocol will work. Cubic, Hydra, we tried DCTCP at most, and for storage network, if you have fat short links, it doesn't matter. Also, we tried, we built a turnout memory automatic shrinking and extending based on user feedback. We plan to introduce something different lately, but this is a kind of failure. We cannot extend memory after we already have event of an ability of memory allocation. It's quite bad. Application is already failed, and seems that's a problem. Nobody wants also CPU hot plug or hot remove because quota is enough. There's very small set of application which needs one powerful core, except say per core licensed databases or so. And I said about NEMA pass-through, we doesn't want it simply. That's the main performance issues we faced just before launch. As I said, we simply thrown out NEMA. It doesn't matter for most kind of regular applications. Transparent huge page usage will be fine. It will reduce amount of context switches. It will reduce overhead. But there's only one problem. It was not working with VirtualBallon at the time, so we simply cannot use it with changeable memory. Idea driver also was awesome, but it limits only on 70 megabytes per second. It was completely finished, but it even supports discard, but we can't use it if we plan to extend it in the future, so we rolled back to the virtual driver, which is quite simple. If someone knows this their architecture, virtual driver has a simplificator architecture, and it still doesn't support discard. Only virtual SCSI does. And as for CEF, we forced to move out from BTRFS because of its state. It's quite unstable, and it remains unfortunately unstable, but it has a almost zero cost snapshot mechanism, so you can roll back and forward snapshots in the CEF without any additional overhead in the file system. It's an atomic operation. So we thrown all it out, fortunately. At the time of release, we have kernel 3.6. All the kernels in free series, as soon as I know, up to 3.6 has a very unstable behavior. under CEF and heavy load, so there was a lot of problem to pin exactly this bug. It's a kind of soft lookup, and throw it out. CEF also has even time of bobtail many leaks, and we are forced to restart them eventually. This behavior can introduce no problem until you're looking for memory consumption from them. And open the switch in time of 3.6 can be turned literally off with 400 RPS scene attack for different IP addresses. So that's a kind of problem. And we have after we went in production, we have a kind of problem. There was users who want to scale the EVMs by order of magnitude using Bellow mechanism. They don't care about mechanism. They simply want to scale the EVMs. Kernel reserves all memory and then Bellow driver loads and says how much memory kernel should expose to the user space. So for 1 gigabytes for one gigabyte VM, which is able to scale to 60 gigabytes, overhead will be about 300 megabytes, which is quite unacceptable. This overhead may be eliminated using kernel same page merging mechanism. So we try it a lot, state only on regular one, which is not crashing immediately, and UKSM, which brought us some memory allocation failures, so we decided to not use it all. Despite this problem, we still want to use online memory addition and removal, and we took SCP head plug, changed it for a little to make it work, so it requires some changes in the CBIOS and in the emulator itself, KVM. Unfortunately, these changes are not being accepted in the mainline, so we're using it standalone. As you can see, there is a lot of slots in the KMU command line, which every of which is pluggable, so we can plug slot of memory, make it online and make it offline. And recently, Linux kernel has a mechanism to offline properly during operations, so we can do offline without reboot of virtual machine. As you can see, CEF is very awesome thing in means of features, and third release with codename Cuttlefish brought in a lot of features, extended intermediate state handling called peeing. So we will not stuck at peering for minutes anymore when cluster decides which data where should be placed. The only one problem is fine tuning. A lot of changes should be made in the default config to make it work. At least number of different queues, file store queues, if someone similar with CEF, he'll understand me. Peering priority, recovery priority, and so on. So at the end of such tuning, you will have really distributed file system with a second or two downtime between any states when you not discarding more than n minus minus 1 copies of data. There are also some assumptions several of users should know. It requires very precise time sync. It depends on link bandwidth, so no one should try to put F on gigabit links except for testing. We're using quadruple rate InfiniBand for 40 gigabits. It was enough for about 1 gigabyte per second linear reads and writes in same time. Of course, we should combine storage and compute roles to reduce overhead in physical nodes. We cannot allow ourselves to isolate compute node, say it can be node without disks, just a computing one, and put above or somewhere else storage node, machine with a lot of disks but with limited memory resources. Combining seems to be a preferable strategy. The only thing we should observe is potential resource exhaustion, which can be avoided using same cgroup mechanism as we already exploiting for the VMs itself. And the most problematic part is the client input-output latencies. For rotating media, we have a very low amount of maximum operations per second, is about 70, which can be raised without any type of cache. So controller cache raises this to about 100 operations per second, which is probably not enough, and we'll see raised latency for reads when we have a lot of clients, say 10 clients per disk doing 5 reads each. It data fragmentation, it will bring our cluster almost to knees. We need to cache it somehow else. We use DM cache, as far I know it's the first kind of this experience in the world. DM cache is pluggable, it's in tree, it's open source, we may freely modify its policies, which of course I made sure to date. And it helped us a lot. We reduced 99% latency for 99% of our requests by order of magnitude from 100 milliseconds to 10 milliseconds. It's almost SSD latency, which is quite good. And we have a ceiling about 100 milliseconds today, so no read will take more than 100 milliseconds just for starting reply. If read is big, of course, it will take a lot of time to answer the client, but it is quite good in means of meeting requirements as for distributed storage or so. There's also some word about self-tuning. You should tune operation priorities first, so recovery priority should be put down and user priority should be put at highest level, they will not interact, and user operations remains at highest priority. And when you grow a cluster, you will face different kind of problems. With say 5 nodes and 50 nodes. In first case, you'll see a bandwidth problem first, and in second case, you will see IOPS limit first. And of course, the bigger cluster is, the less amount of time it takes to peering its internal CEPH operation to be completed, and the less freeze for client's operations will be. So, what about choosing network platform? We want to use AirSocket support for CEPH. It's sockets within RDMA, so it has lower overhead than a regular IP over InfiniBand. They are not ready yet. We are trying to use it, and we are actively working on it. So until we have a need to migrate VM cross racks, we may stay on flat storage network. I mentioned that before. So we may stay on InfiniBand, which doesn't scale on VMs of regular Ethernet network scales. And for Ethernet segment, we choose hardware to build current network, and which will remain in the future when we completely switch to the OpenFlow. No one of famous vendors have a switch with completely open firmware. It has only OpenFlow layout with some version of compatibility, and we choose PK8 because it has completely open firmware, excluding Broadcom module, and it runs open vSwitch, and which can be put in the OpenFlow mode or can work standalone. And of course, it helped us a little to build our current network. So, why do we choose OpenFlow? Why do we switch to it? Because in standalone OVS, you cannot filter per switch set of MAX. You may set filter per port, but when you try to put the same rules on the switch, which is which stays over couple of VMs, sending the same rules could be difficult. You may not know which MAC address you're asking and what you should answer to him, or should you drop him. Of course, this means that the public segment can be filtered only using IP tables or so. So this is kind of problem. We need to eliminate this. Of course, there is no L2 filtering. There will be a lot of broadcasts, and it also may stop our scaling. Say one or at one at 1,000th of VMs. Yeah. Of course, we need traffic pattern analysis to prevent potential spam, because we don't want to be put in the blacklists. And when users send, say, 10,000 emails, we can check if he is not spammer, and we can prevent this before abuse happens. So OpenFlow OpenFlow may help us to do this. So we choose to switch to OpenFlow at once. That was quite simple, because we already have VM to VM relation. So is these two VMs belongs to the same client? If so, then the packet flow from local network from one VM can be forwarded to the local port of second VM or so. And if and we also do MAC filtering and IP filtering with OpenFlow, so packet which seems to not belong to this VM, but our logic will not pass even input port filter, so it will be fine. So we choose Floodlight because it was almost major as open daylight, and somehow it was simply to write extension to him to work with our orchestration instead of the open daylight. So it's hardly to use POX or NOX because of their current architecture. We can build something like cross IDC overlay networks in the future with very small effort. I just need to add some logic on the top of current one. That should be no problem. And we still not finished multiple controller synchronization. It means that the OpenVSH can be used for a set of controllers, and in case of failure, it can switch to another, and same rules will be pushed. That's a minute of thinking about current state of software network and software storage, software-defined storage. Since we can move a VM everywhere inside our data center, do we need really to build a relay networks for them inside the same data center? Because we can reduce distance to make possible to work regular level 2 traffic, not the overlay one. That's the question. CEF allows you to make atomic snapshot, as I said before, and we can freeze virtual machine, replace file descriptors on the fly, and switch to the snapshot and unfreeze VM. It will work as with original image, and Target snapshot maybe belongs to the different pool, say, pool in different rack. So we did migration in such strange way. And of course, we can migrate VM lately when we migrate all the data. Right now, we have only filtering and forwarding task in the OpenFlow. So filtering was done in the scope of one host, and later we plan to extend it to the hardware switch, so amount of broadcast will be reduced because port will be broadcast from one port will be forwarded only to this port, which is known to contain any other VMs from same client. So it will be a point. Okay, so what we have right now? No automatic ballooning yet in the Linux. I mean, automatic ballooning should never return enumem ever, because it should add memory first when we're doing request, and it came in additional memory request, and it will came in slow path. Then we just dedicate some memory, and balloon will extend, and slow paths complete with success, so application will never fail. We plan to implement this mechanism by ourselves in say in half of year. Despite in recent kernel release we have merged not we but Linux community have merged ICPI memory shrinking mechanism, so we can put a movable region on any real memory region and then offline it and then remove it. It seems to not working to date, so no, it's not able to remove memory from the host without using ballooning mechanism. That's a key point too. Transparent huge pages, despite this, they giving some performance boost are not working with Bellon, and the, what is more important, they are not working with memory over commit. So you can allocate only predefined amount of huge pages and use it. You can cannot allocate lot of virtual memory, allow this error commit and put transparent huge pages on it. That's the architecture problem, and we hopefully see it will be solved in the near future. So, and for distributions, there's no distribution contains from stable set, of course. I mean, it doesn't include Fedora, Arch Linux, or something bleeding edge. No one regular distros, says is precise. Red Hat and so on contains a new kernel with automatic, with online partitioning resize. So we cannot resize a partition without reboot, and it's a kind of stopper for our work. We had implemented online partition resize using Jest agent, notification through Camo, and a couple of distros still can't use it. So what we may do to in the near future, despite things I discussed before. So we want to build a FAT network segment on top of current one and put two level silos and move this entire construction to the open flow to make possible advanced traffic engineering, so we can reduce amount of traffic coming from any to any cross section using only our software logic, nothing more. We also plan to complete work with Cepher sockets to make Cepher and Gluster stay on same line here, because Ceph doesn't support RDMA in any way. And we want to write and try to put in mainline after ballooning mechanism, as I said before, which has no failures when memory tried to be allocated. Okay, since I have some time. Is there any questions? Okay, so may I show some of my backup slides? That's kind of talk for VM scalability. We thought about distributed virtual machines in the beginning of our development. Virtual machines can and current CAMO logic can be easily converted to work with distributed memory and distributed CPUs, but it needs to work. It needs by very specific kind of applications, say no malware databases, even MySQL is NumaAware, but nobody will put it in such large environment. We decided to not continue work on it. It just one of unneeded features. The second point is about our cloning mechanism. As I mentioned before, we can clone virtual machine and launch it in a matter of seconds using Ceph flatten mechanism, rewrite any setting related to hardware identifiers and to the network. So that's the point to extend this to support at least in the cloud stack, because OpenStack should not rely on the Ceph as cloud stack does. And we're waiting for RDMA camo migration, which came is in camo 1.7, and still it's very experimental. It will allow to reduce time of migration from current tens of seconds for offline migration to second or two, and will reduce performance overhead for the live migration. Such things as XBZ earlier is in place, but it they will have only with specific kinds of workloads, not the regular ones. So if you spinning up very large VMs and putting just a big web server on it, XBZ relay will not help. That's all. So I still have 3 minutes. Okay. So
do you try and fail over from site to a remote site?
Yeah, it allows it. It's called geo replication, and we simply just need to set it up, and it will work flawlessly in Cuttlefish and newer releases.
I'm thinking of in terms of your memory bandwidth problems. You're on InfiniBand, obviously locally.
We can put one long-range InfiniBand. It exists, and okay. Mellanox selling it right now, so it's not a problem at all. Okay, so no more questions.
You're using DM cache on top of RBD?
Not. We are not using kernel drivers, so DM cache is plugged only for file store. So, no more questions, then that's all. Thank you.